professional regulations, of course, because we are delivering care services, we do have professional concerns raised. So again, it's about what form and how we build that through. And also, when things do go wrong, it's what functions we have around incidents, and when they come to a serious incident room, whether it's through a coroner's report, or whether it's through a contractual meeting. So they were just some of the things that I wanted to sort of highlight. What I wanted to confuse regarding is Article 35 was looking at how we as a team then, with all the information that we get, what we actually do with it. I think this is the critical bit. I think the most important thing is it's around, we use the word quite often, it's around how we try and relate that data. So what we do as a quality and safety team is we work very closely with the commissioners, because they're all have a number of contracts running alongside these. So how Nesta has talked about the commission decision policy, all the bureau lines are running alongside those things. And so a lot of the things that we need to do is look at the information that we have, and through a regular contractual process is we monitor and manage a contract. If things start to go off, looking at the things that we have, what we try and look at then is, do we have persistent or increasing quality concerns with a provider, and what do we need to do next? And some of those things we need to do, some of the tools that we've got in our armoury, is we might need to step up that what we call enhanced surveillance. So ordinarily we might have a monthly contract meeting with a provider. Some concerns start coming through, so some of those things that are identified start coming through. We might have a poor CQC report, we might see complaints coming through. So it's starting to raise some concerns for us. So what we normally do then is we go out and we investigate. So my team will go out just to see what's going on within that provider. Some of those can be, as I say, visits, it can be asking for more information, or it can actually be asking the provider to come in and talk about that single item that we have. From that, we might then say, okay, we're assured, fantastic. We'll step that back down and go back into a routine quality monitoring. But actually, it might, we're not assured of this, we actually need more to do. So again, we put on an improvement programme, and we actually bring the provider in, perhaps for a number of meetings, and we go out and we check, we look at improvement plans, we ask them to set trajectories. If they say they're going to do it by a certain day, we then go and check whether that has been done. We use lots of different agencies as well in order to support us with this. So we can use Health Watching, we'll do an interim view, which we found has been very useful. We might use our environmental health officers to support us through some things. We might use our infection prevention control team. So again, all the time we're triangulating information to find out what the root of our issues are. In the centre of all this, of course, is our service users and their carers as well, because that's some really valuable information that we get. Sometimes we find that our users are actually quite pleased with the service that they receive, but actually our data is telling us otherwise, and that's quite an interesting conversation to have actually, and that's when our social worker nursing colleagues need to work with our users to actually get them to understand what good care should look like, because some people accept not so good care. So I think it's incumbent on us to actually say this is what good should look like, and this is the standard of care that we should be having. So this is sort of how we sort of look at it. That's very much from a local perspective, but also what my role is to look at things sort of on a bigger perspective, which is a regional perspective. So I will report any quality concerns to what we've got, which is called a quality surveillance group. The importance of that is that if we have a provider, which is a national company, for example, just because I've got issues in Wirral, there may be issues in Liverpool or in Cheshire as well, and again, that's really important because we can actually tackle it on a bigger footprint. So again, it's using bigger resources in order to tackle some of those care problems. information there, but I'm happy to take any questions or concerns.
Thank you very much, Lorna.
It answers a lot of questions. I'm really pleased to see how robust it is. But if we are commissioning, we need to be able to demonstrate that we're commissioning properly and that we're testing and making sure we're getting value up. So that's a big responsibility. So thank you for that report. It's really robust and reassuring.
Safeguarding the quality assurance duties that extend across. So any services provided to vulnerable people or patients will be supported by this.
Yeah, you do differentiate. So if, for example, we look at that provider, we don't look at the person, whether they've paid themselves or whether they're a local authority payment or a healthcare payment. We look at that provider and we take responsibility for those individuals.
Thanks, Graham. Yes. Can I just make a commentary? We know some of the staff have moved on to work with you. I know what fantastic people they are and how committed they are. And it absolutely makes sense to me that everybody is now joined up together. And I think, you know, this is the sort of work that's taking away that we really don't publicise enough. The work that's done in, for instance, cables and the rest of it. And I absolutely commend the team. I think they are doing a wonderful job. So thank you very much for this.
I'll pass that on to the team.
Yeah, please do. So we've been asked to know the functions, processes and governance in place in relation to quality and safety for the health and care commissioning, and to know the processes that are in place to identify quality concerns in order that action is taken in a planned and consistent manner. So from a personal point of view, are you happy?
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm surprised if we're not happy because this is describing what most of we know already.
Yeah.
Everyone happy for the record? Thank you very much.
Now the next item, unfortunately, is a repeat of the first item, and the draft commissioning and transformation strategy. strategy was the one that was sent out late on Thursday, and we, I hope people have had a chance to look at it.
I can talk about the decision policy again if you like. The time.
Come on then, Nesta. Yeah, sorry, it's, so this one is now an urgent business in the business rather than where it should have been on the report. So, Nesta, over to you.
Thank you. So, again, this strategy we've been developing as part of our plan to integrate as commissioners. And you heard me talk in the decision policy before about when we make decisions, it is aligned to that, and to make sure that our decisions when we're commissioning services fit in with our strategy for Wirral. And again, this does align with the Council 2020 and the Healthy Wirral Plan and everything. And this is about us as commissioners and how we've integrated. So this strategy is all about how we need to improve health and care for outcomes for people on Wirral. And you know, we are doing well, and it's not all doom and gloom, and I wouldn't like anybody to think, oh, we're all terrible on Wirral. We're not, but we have got room for improvement. There are areas that we could improve on. And I think, for me, this strategy is about making sure that as an integrated team, it's driving through where we're going, so that we're not all going off on different tangents, that we know exactly where we're going. And it's given us that plan of work, really, for the next 3 years. And as well as this, I think it's already starting to frame how we expect our providers, and that's providers in the wider sense, to work together as well. And it's helping to give them direction as well. So going through the strategy, you'll see it talks about this, the strategic context. So it talks about the local and some of the national work that's been done there and how it all fits together. It then goes on about our case for change, and it does talk about you know, the Wirral view, which I'm sure you're all aware of here, and just, you know, some of the key issues there. You know, our largest cause for avoidable death, you can see, was for cancer, and there, because there are things that we, you know, they're classed as that because it's believed that we could have done something to help prevent it. So it's about, as they call it, shift left, but it's about us how we look further up the pathway for somebody. And again, the next one after that was cardiovascular disease as well. So again, there's more that we can do to make that difference. The paper also talks about our financial pressures, which Mike Traherne and Anna, you know, they've already touched on before. So we know that as an economy, and that includes our big acute hospital, we are an economy under some pressure. So I think the key issues, and you know, you'll know about this, but for Wirral, we've got our ageing population, we've got poorer health outcomes, so that, you know, we compare ourselves to the rest of England. There's that wide range variation, and yet we live so close together, don't we? You know, it's such a small geography, but there's the wide variation. I think we've recognised that health and care organisations haven't worked together, and you know, Lorna's already given examples of how as we've integrated as commissioners, it's making much more sense to us. We know that too many people go into hospital when they could have stayed at home, and when they are in hospital, they stay for too long as well. So again, it's about, we want people to be at home. And again, Wirral isn't specific for this, it's the same everywhere. More of us are expecting more for our the care that we receive as well. So our expectations has gone up as well. So I think that really sums up that we know that we need to change how we work on Wirral, and that was our recognition as commissioners. We then talk about the Healthy Wirral, the outcome framework. I'll talk a little bit more about that later, and about our current work plans in the Healthy Wirral. So this blockbusters theme. So that's some of our enabling work streams and our priority work streams that we're working on. But I think what I wanted to look on more today was our commissioning intentions, really. And as part of that, I think as an integrated commissioner, we want to lead the service transformation across Wirral. And I strongly believe that as a commissioner, one of our most important roles is to be an advocate for the public more than a provider can, because I always feel that they've got their very narrow view of the world, potentially from their provider view. commissioner, we look across the whole of the system. So for me, our priority is very much about developing this place-based commissioning approach. And it makes absolute sense when I think about how we currently commission things in chunks. So we have different contracts, I couldn't tell, we have hundreds of different contracts. And one service pathway might well have, currently it could have public health, CCG, and then a local authority contract, all doing different bits, and then we wonder why people don't have a good experience of care. So this place-based care is about how we're going to commission things in a much joined-up way. And it's very much focusing on people and place. So when you look at the maps that are there on page, it's on page 18, but I've got a separate. This was developed with public health, and I have to admit, so going into the usual, well, we'll do it on provider footprint, we initially looked at this on a GP practice footprint, but that was a provider footprint, and this isn't about providers, this is about place. So this is very much, these nine neighbourhoods are about looking at the places and where they're best matched together. So it was public health that helped to develop those maps for us. And they've been agreed by the providers. They had some issues potentially, but we said, no, this isn't about providers, this is about the place. So our absolute priority now is to look at the neighbourhood teams, and we're looking to start setting them up in first meeting in July. So again, you know, we're continuing to work on how we can align services better. So on page 19, it gives a bit more detail about the neighbourhood. So we talk about there's the 51 GP practices, the nine neighbourhoods, which is around this, you know, going back to our three Ps, the place population. There's the four localities and then the one Wirral. So there are some things that will fit, they'll still need to be done at four. There are some that need to be done at one, some that need to be done at 51. But for me, that absolute game changing how services will be delivered is the neighbourhood, because it's about a lot of the community will be wrapped around the neighbourhood, and we're going to empower those neighbourhoods to start to really look at what their needs of that their neighbourhood is, not as providers but as a group of people. So you'll see there when it talks about neighbourhoods that is this partnership. So it's about primary, secondary, mental health, social care, and, you know, very important, it's community and the voluntary sector all coming together. At the moment, we're all in different places, so this is about getting the NHS services together, but not in isolation, which I think we might well have done before, but it's about saying, come on everybody, social care, voluntary sector, everybody, let's come together and look at what the needs are that we've got in this neighbourhood. We are appointing, hopefully later this week, a GP that will act as the neighbourhood coordinator, and it's so that they can bring all of the people, those key people together as that leader for that neighbourhood, but then they will work together across, because what we don't want is to have some neighbourhoods that might go off and do on a tangent, you know, so again, we'll still be ensuring that they fit into the four and the one model as well. But that neighbourhood will look at what their population needs are and look at stratifying. So looking at, well, who is the people at most need for us? And it isn't the same. So in the past we've said, we expect you to make a difference on these outcomes and then deliver it in the same way for each neighbourhood, as we call them now, across Wirral. Knowing that in Wirral, we're a very different place, aren't we, from Birkenhead to Easton. It's a different population. So we're going to help people when they come together in their neighbourhoods to look at what is it that you need in your neighbourhood and what is it that your services need to start delivering, because what are the people telling you that's important to them? So what we're going to work on first is the frailty population, so that's the 50 plus we're calling it, but it will predominantly initially, and it links to our quick plan, looking at the frailty people, so, or what classed as frailty, and that can be a whole host of definitions. And I think what we know is that when we look at variation throughout Whittle, that there are some neighbourhoods that that look, seem to look after people very well, and not many people go into hospital. And there are other areas of that population that go into hospital a lot, not in a planned way, in a non-elective way, so they're going in as an emergency, if you like, which is not the best way to get into hospital at all, is it? So what the focus is for those neighbourhoods is to look at that those population that they've got in their neighbourhood, who are they that are going in, and what can you do as a collective? And it might be that Age UK have already done some piece of work in the neighbourhoods to ask people. And I know PETS came out as one of the important things for them. So again, you know, this isn't us thinking as a NHS or you've got to fit into our services. This is about what is it that people need and how can we help them to make sure services are coordinated. I think for the neighbourhoods it could be something, so at the moment you can envisage that a person might have four different services because they might have four different things that they need help with, and they might all go on the same day or they might all go on different days, but they won't speak to each other and nobody would be saying, oh, I'm a bit worried about Mrs. Jones, are you? I'm not. You know, they're not talking together. So this is about wrapping care around very much. So on page 21, we talk about that's our first focus is on the frailty, because as we said before, we know we've got that ageing population. But also as part of that, it's working not just on that population, but what can we do before people get to be frail, whatever that means to people. Part of the next steps is to very much work. So we've got outcomes, there are draft outcomes at the back of this, and we want to work through the neighbourhoods from July to November to co-produce. It's called a prospectus, but it's like it'd be more like a service description of what it is that we want for our neighbourhoods to deliver from next April. And as commissioners, we'll look at to see how we can fund that in a very different way. So not widget counting, so not how many people, but what are the outcomes and how can you make a difference about that. So that's the work that we're going to be starting on, we're hoping to do from July to November, is to co-produce this prospectus for everybody. And I think that is the whistle stop talk. Sorry, I know I get very passionate about the neighbourhoods because I just think that they make absolute sense.
Graham,
come
in first.
Okay, so for me, just in a nutshell, it strikes me that what you've said, Nesta, is that the current system is very fragmented. The internal market with different parts of the NHS competing for business isn't working particularly well for us as a system. What we're trying to drive here is a system of collaboration where providers from primary care, from acute care, from community services work together to deliver better outcomes at the neighbourhood level. There's a set of outcomes at the back in terms of the sorts of things that we expect to see improved. But the key thing here, the narrative, is all about collaboration. It's all about working at that level to understand what the communities need and want in a much more kind of granular way, rather than focusing our efforts on procurement contracts and the kind of, if you like, national measures applied in a very sort of blanket sort of way. So I think for me this takes us to a different place as commissioners in terms of a real strong focus on outcomes. Our role is shifting very much in terms of that relationship with communities and that deal, which is very much in line with the All Together plans all around how we're going to ensure the services are delivered differently in our life.
First of all, declaration of interest that I made for Age UK, I manage all community equity, so just so you know. And you're right, talking to people, you will find out exactly what they need, and you call them as a judge, I call the place I have as always now, you know, we don't even see now, you know, Nelly's needs. I think it's a great report. The only caveat I have with it is I don't want to be in a position where Age UK takes the place of what should be NHS. So I'm just really worried that through our commissioning, if there's a medical need, the medical need may be over. Because if Delhi keeps falling over, it's no use me going in and keeping picking Nelly up and giving her a cup of tea. like to know that somebody somewhere will say there's a medical need to find out why now keeps going over. So I'm just concerned that within that report there doesn't seem to be a caveat that says NHS, there will always be, there's acute care, the acute care is covered, I'm not worried about the acute care, I'm worried about the bit below the acute care.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, we can't have that. And I think so what could happen is that the statutory services, if you like, will continue to deliver what they deliver. But what happens currently, because things are not joined up together, that people have needs, but it's for the NHS, if you like, or the local authority, that, well, you don't meet our criteria, so we can't help you with that, walking your dog, or, it's a company, or taking you here, oh, I can't do that, it's not what I do. So I think it's making sure that the holistic needs are looked at and are dealt with the most appropriate person. Absolutely, we do not want that happening because people have skills, don't they? And when we're in, I think it's that wrapped around holistic care.
Two questions
really
for Paula. On page 6, you talked about multi-year contract basic service. I just wondered if you didn't just look at that and explain to me why there's a difference in the council care organisation. And also on page
27. So I think what was the first question about the single multi-year contract.
Yeah.
So if we take frailty for example, what that is not about accountable care. So this is about exactly what Graham said, this is about asking people to collaborate together. So that would be, our request would be to providers, and I think it does say it later in the strategy, that we don't want competition, we want them to work together. So what we'd be looking at is to have a contract, and that could be an alignment. The framework of the contract is relevant. It's about that we want you to deliver the outcomes through one contract, rather than half, because what happens currently is that we have separate contracts and then people say, I can't see you because you don't fit what I'm supposed to do with that part of the pathway. So it's more about having a contract that will enable coordination. It's absolutely not accountable care. And our provider, if they were here, I don't think they would envisage that that's where they're going either.
So you're right about this?
Yeah, providers, well, they're going to integrate, aren't they? Yeah, but yeah, they don't see it as an accountable care either.
So we're an integrated provider partnership. It's currently made up of Wirral University Teaching Hospital, Cheshire Partnership Trust, Wirral Community Foundation Trust, the Primary Care Federations, and Wirral Council. So we're an integrated provider partnership. So the idea is that within that Wirral integrated provider partnership, we need to find the appropriate contract vehicle to work with those organisations.
So that's trying to stop budget counting, which I find difficult to do. So this is about, again, as Graham said, moving very much into more outcomes. So if we want that outcome, how much would we expect to pay for that population? So that's what this is about, not about it's absolutely not the accountable care. So this is more about how we can commission in a more, and I will look to change the wording, it's about getting outcomes, not asking providers to have different contracts where we're counting budgets.
There's one of the concerns expressed to me regarding budgets, most of the money going to us. He says, we'll just, and then the one that's come to the top,
say we've run out of our money in the NHS because we had a deficit. But so Michael says we're spending other people's money as part of the NHS from other areas. So, and we wouldn't ever give all of our money to a provider, never.
No,
we did. Accountable care, you're talking
about? No, the capacity is budgets. So you've got to set budgets.
So that would be a good thing.
Once we've spent all the money, that's.
So, did you comment? So, the Rural Council works to a single budget, as a capacity budget, if you like, it gets a budget. The NHS has a budget target, Mike mentioned that earlier on today, in terms of the £2 million set, but there's a fixed amount of money available to the local economy within that. The issue at the moment is that it's separated out in lots and lots of different contracts. What we're expecting is that providers working together and having a clear understanding of what the budget available is will be able to work in a much more effective manner to be able to use that resource efficiently. Now, there has been news in terms of additional money coming into the NHS for frontline services. We'll have to see what the impact of that is as well in terms of an increase, but the increase is significant because I think life is about 3% per annum.
Going forward?
Yeah.
That's going forward.
Yeah. So, unlike the council, the NHS will have 3.4% growth annually. And work within that. But I think what we're saying is those sort of decisions will still need to be made in terms of how to deliver services effectively to people. But you're right, there is a finite envelope, Stuart. But there is currently a finite envelope. It's just what happens with that finite envelope is that it leads to significant overspend and a lot of contract discussion.
Well, I think
Alan
pointed out to the other end the fact, you know, that we need to to our budgets anyway, as an integrated commission
involved. So, normally you would take 1 year with the NHS with the health service, so the hope for anything is different statute, you can't overspend. If it doesn't overspend, then you're subject to a set of directions that are different to ours, but the inspectors or people who come in. And with that, we'd expect it to recover the deficit that we've endured is probably good. So what if you looked at our report in terms of warnings, what you've got is effectively the in-year position or the end-year position, which I'm selling, and then the cumulative deficit, which we will then be expected to pay back a dividend. So part of the rationale for why Jesse giving us a £2 million surplus is the start of paying control to us, to start trying to pay back some of that accumulated deficit. Now, equally, if you look at some of the organisations that historically have much bigger deficits, these have been building for years, and they're what I call structural deficits because they're not really solvable by easy fixes. You need to have a major transformation or money coming. So I think, you know, the issue of the capitation budget is technically right, but in practice it's probably slightly different.
Longevity in terms of
starting to need services more, but also looking at that population health and looking at how can we deliver to those particular areas what's needed, because from West Wirral to Birkenhead, it would be considerably different. And it's drawing in on the services that Age UK and that lots of other third sector can provide, but using that in tandem with health and not instead of. So it can be used instead of in certain areas, but not all the time. And so if a patient's falling over, it's why do they need an ECG, what's their eyesight, what needs to be done from the health point of view, but also, you know, do they need to get sterile now because they're tripping on their stairs? And it's looking at it from that point of view.
Yeah, just a quick comment. I thought Stuart's comment about the capitated budget work were interesting, because I was looking at that part of the report as well. It's on page 20 as far as the document's concerned, but I find the paragraph at the bottom of that page reassuring in terms of the way in which the development of capitation budgeting is described. It's going to be an iterative process and checks and balances built in, but given that it's a fairly optimistic or ambitious target to have it in place in 3 years' time, I just wonder whether or not we need to have a progression of papers here to describe the progress that's made and the key decisions that need to be made, because I imagine we're going to get into conversations about the extent to which the full budget can be devolved to individual neighbourhoods and what kind of mitigations or reserves or whatever we choose to call it to ensure that both organisations are still able to deliver their statutory functions as well as letting loose the purse strings in that kind of devolved fashion and obviously the lack of control potentially that goes with that approach.
So I think the thing is, if it was when these things have been done in the past, what you usually have is a case of change in policy, because what you can bet is the breakup of the budget by locality will not equate on a capitation basis to the actual usage of expenditure or the incurrence of expenditure. Yeah. The reality will be there that certain neighbours will probably be overspending their notional capitated budget, and can then bring that back in line. And that's where the pace of change policy would come in. And equally, what factors do we use to determine how that budget should be spent? Because what we know is that in certain areas, if we want to improve life expectancy, mortality rate, we may have to invest disproportionately in those areas, right? Which actually will be up with a fair share of capitation by neighbourhood. So I think those are things that we're going to have to face going forward, and we'll have to be very clear about the criteria, the timing, and what I call the pace of change. And I wouldn't disagree that 3 years is relatively ambitious. The growth funding, if it comes without a caveat, would allow us actually probably to invest more in the areas that we need to target. Yeah, so what you can do when you get growth is you apply a disproportionate into the area that you want the target to improve mortality, etc. Again, if you're in a locality where you may want more services and you have a population that may be healthy but actually more demanded in terms of public voice and vociferous, those are things that has to be considered in that policy.
Essentially, we're talking about a long term financial strategy that is completely different to what we're both familiar with at the moment. It's quite a challenge.
And the more you break it down, the more risk there is, because the smaller the population, the more risk is attached to that. And we will unlikely, I think, is the first thing to enter into risk share by neighbourhood or between neighbourhoods to say, well, there's going to be some kind of risk to you to guarantee the statutory duties of what the authority on the CCG.
Yes, I think
that
you have to be
really
careful as well, because I believe totally targeted approach, because you're quite right that the residents of Seacombs need to completely different to the residents of Hesley. possible, but what you also need to realise is that the residents of Heswell, there's an awful lot of social isolation there, there's an awful lot of poverty up there. They tend to be asset rich and more poor, and that brings risks and problems all of its own. So quite often when we're talking about vulnerable societies and vulnerable communities, we talk about the rights of the sick and the rights of the Birkenhead. And there's a hidden crisis, I think, going on in some of our really more, what would we call, profitable areas, you know, because it's all in behind closed doors.
Thank you.